mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Talagang durog na durog na ho kami. Kanapaw, ang binikinakain ho namin sa umaga, tuyo na lang. Tuyo sa tanghali. Pati ba naman sa gabi, tuyo pa.
Saglit nga 2 times a day. Ano once a day na lang kumakain. Sandaan ng isang kain. Para makamahiwi sa pamilya.
Karanas naman po talaga kami na ano, hindi nakakain. Puro lang tubig.
The numbers are beginning to show we're getting some headway in the battle against COVID-19, but we're not out of the woods just yet. And the focus must now shift to sustaining these gains. Hi, I'm Karmina Constantino. Join me as we once again talk to Edson Guido, head of the ABS-CBN News Data Analytics team. We're going to scrutinize those numbers and see how both Filipinos and the Philippine economy can go back to the pink of health. This is ANC Presents COVID-19 in Numbers. Let's begin by looking at where we're at right now. You know, health officials here in the Philippines have been saying that we're not considered low risk from COVID-19. You've got bed utilization rates in hospitals, that's falling as well. So is it safe to say we're winning against COVID-19, or are we once again falling into that trap of complacency? Edson, where are we in terms of the latest trend on cases? What can you tell us about that?
Definitely, we saw a lot of improvements across the different indicators. As you can see from this chart right here, which shows us the number of cases through time, what we're seeing now is that the daily average has fallen to below 5,000, which is the lowest since March, and the positivity rate is also below 10%. Our ICU bed occupancy and in Metro Manila are now in the safe zone, which is below 60%. So really, it's a lot of improvements across the different indicators. And if you would look at the breakdown from this chart, in areas outside Metro Manila, which is represented by those blue bars there. Mm-hmm. So really, it's a lot of, in terms of the numbers, are relatively good compared to the previous months.
So that's the trend right now, but barring any unforeseen circumstances, anything that will derail this trend, where do you think then these numbers will be headed, Edson?
Definitely for now, we're seeing a lot of improvements, but this, we're not yet out of the woods. And for me, our collective action now will dictate where we're heading in the next few weeks. So we really need to vaccinate more people, as well as ensure that our people will continue to observe minimum health protocols so that our trend will be sustained. Positivity rate, I mentioned earlier that it's below 10%, that is correct, but the WHO benchmark is a positivity rate of 5% or lower for at least 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. And we're not yet there. And we have to reach that point first and then have to stay there for a few more weeks.
Well, still, Edson, you can almost hear sort of this collective sigh coming from the people, and you can almost feel that people are beginning to breathe easy again. But the past year's numbers show that there is a steep climb ahead of us. Tell us more about that.
Yes, that's correct, because if you would remember last year when the government initially imposed the community quarantine in March 2020, a lot of us just thought during the time that it would only last for a few weeks or 1 to 2 months maximum. But what we saw was, we didn't see that, and what we saw from this chart is that we saw a prolonged high number of cases, which generated a sense of fatigue. Mm. And if you would look at the numbers here, especially plummeted to a record low last year, but as you can see from right here, it shows consumer confidence in blue. Mm-hmm. You would see that when it fell to its lowest level last year, we're now seeing an improvement in the previous quarters, but it remains to be in the negative territory. Mm-hmm. But as for the business confidence, which is in orange, you would see that in the last quarter, it fell to its lowest level since the 2009 global financial crisis. And this is mainly attributed to the adverse effect of the businesses. And really, when we talk about consumer confidence and business confidence, it is very important to restore consumer confidence, especially for the Philippines, which is largely a consumption-driven economy. So restoring consumer confidence is a necessary condition for economic growth.
Which we're going to talk more about when we return after this break. When we come back, we'll talk about how Filipinos are looking for more work to make ends meet amid higher prices. ANC Presents COVID-19 and Numbers. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide...
And we're back. Before we were talking about how it has affected this consumption economy, deeper into data is going to clearly show one thing. company that we speak of is not doing well because the consumer is unwell. Back with us, Edson Guido, head of the ABS-CBN. So Edson, when we talk about the consumer, how can he even begin to buy goods and help bring this economy back to life when this pandemic has taken away the very source of that power, their jobs?
That is, you look at this chart right here on unemployment, you would see that unemployment rate 2005, with the worst of it happening here during ECQ last year. And as you would notice, the chart is now quite lower, the unemployment rate, but it remains elevated relative to the period before the pandemic. So really, we also have to talk about mobility and the role that it played, because businesses didn't just cut jobs. A lot of people weren't really able to go to work in the first place with all these restrictions. So if you would look at all these numbers during the latest jobs data for August, the ECQ was actually the second most cited reason for people missing work.
Right. The bigger story, of course, here as well. Right now, we're talking about unemployment. But there's another story here, Edson, and it's underemployment. And there's a rising number to that. Tell us more about it.
Well, the underemployment rate now is on an upward trend, as you can see in this chart right here, the one in orange. And you know, if we just talk about unemployment rate, it doesn't really tell us the whole picture, because we have to go back to the definition of unemployment. And it means that a person is defined as employed if he or she worked for at least an reference period. Imagine you just work for 1 to 2 hours and you're already considered employed. So definitely these people who were considered employed but only worked for, let's say, 2 to 3 hours, they would definitely find their income insufficient and they would have to look for more work, and just to make ends meet.
And to further illustrate that, let's listen to the story, take a look at the story of a nurse, a frontliner, who's really been trying to make ends meet amid this pandemic.
I'm a government nurse along Pasig. I am in surgical intensive care unit for almost 15 years na po. And then before pandemic, meron akong naging nakitang company na pwede kong maging second job, which is about sa financial literacy. Oh. And then yun po yung naging, parang second job. And at the same time, may yung sa pagiging vaccinator or flu vaccine, pneumovaccine. Kasi ngayon, ang hirap na lang mag-settle ka lang sa isang job. So, lalo mayroon din akong 2 kids and di rin naman din enough yung mga income namin ng husband ko para ma-cater yung mga needs ng namin, ng family. So, I have to do extra jobs. Ayun lang, medyo naapektuhan yung mga errands ko kasi aside from being nurse, tapos may mga extracurricular na jobs. I am also a mother at the same time. So, may mga anak din ako. Yun yung talaga nasa sacrifice po. Yung mga errands sa bahay, hindi ko na talaga siya totally nagagawa. 100%.
That nurse, Angel Ross Villanueva, is just one of the many who have found themselves underemployed. Thank you, by the way, Angel, for sharing your story with us. You know, when you talk about underemployment, Edson, it's not a choice. It's something that you need to do just to make ends meet. And the reason behind that really is inflation. Tell us more about that.
As you can see from this chart here on inflation, you would see that inflation actually reached a near 3-year high in August this year. And for the monthly rates, we would also see that it actually breached the government target of 2-4%. And it was mainly driven by the higher prices of food. And you would see from this table right here that for the prevailing prices of pork and rice, we would see that it was actually in 2020. The past few months where the consumer was really hit heavily by the higher prices of food. And this is just for NCR. For the whole country, you would also see that there is a higher inflation for meat, for fish, and for vegetables. So really, the complete picture, as you can see from these charts that we presented, is very clear. People lost their jobs, and for the fortunate few that were able to save their jobs, a lot of them were also underemployed. So we're not only talking about the availability of jobs, but also the quality of jobs. And all these things are made even worse of goods and services.
Yeah, and we haven't even talked about the reason behind the higher prices of goods and services, because not just about the pandemic. That's the reason why we're seeing these high prices of goods and services. We've had several storms this year as well, and that also contributed to the instability of these prices, correct?
Yes, that is correct. And that results in higher prices of vegetables. And we also have the African swine fever impact. And so we're seeing all these factors leading to a higher inflation for this year 2021.
But it's not all about bad news. There are some bright spots that we're seeing currently, and that's how people have been adapting to the many changes that we've been seeing because of this pandemic. Up ahead, we'll talk about how Filipinos are adapting to the new reality of a people and an economy hit hard by COVID-19. ANC Presents COVID-19 and Numbers will return after the break. Stay with us.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
This is like the pandemic. Contragutom.
COVID has no doubt. have learned to trust technology and not the information that's happening.
Digital payments. More than doubled, and different sectors we have. So there's sweet.
Businesses during this pandemic. Take a look at the story of this wholesaler turned digital retailer.
Actually, the business has been around since 2015. And we started as a wholesaler of fruits and vegetables. So we focus on wholesale, not retail. But when it started, you know, because before we supplied hotels, restaurants, how can we, you know, switch to retail? Then one day, our neighbors from our community started asking, "Hey, are you selling vegetables?" When the pandemic started, it was hard to market. Onions like that. We started, you know, selling retail. Then that's actually like think of ways how to, you know, get in touch with more people. Facebook, Instagram, you know, third party delivery couriers to deliver.
Priority. We discussed in the previous episode that a lot of them are basically online, doing online classes. So we would think right now, what would be the future productivity?
physician, Dr. Teddy Manan.
Continues to make impact on the nutritional and security status of Filipinos, especially those who are vulnerable, like our children. And based on the Rapid Nutrition Assessment, or RNAS, by the Department of Science and Technology, USD, FNRI, the survey results showed that 6 out of 10, or 62.1% of the surveyed households reportedly experienced moderate to severe food insecurity. And that pregnant members from the NRI. Also, it was in the two area. And the majority of children in different areas. The nutrition assessment survey. During the survey. So if solved, this is a differences that we're experiencing for a long time. Children and this will further be resulting to a weakening of the immune system, leading to frequent attacks of illnesses. Such factors.
Things are beginning to last earlier on the trend, barring any negative circumstances, you expect the trend to be lower, still the numbers to go lower. That's, of course, coupled with vaccination, coupled as well with, you know, people sticking to minimum health protocols. But as things are beginning to look up, as we hope for the economy, the says it may take 10 years to sustain the country. So it's a map out long and hard to go.
Well, for us to sustain the gains, we definitely need to strengthen our health system. If you reopen the economy while your cases make consumption activity, so
consumers safe, keep the consumer healthy, and you will see the economy presents.